HarperCollins and Harper Audio present How Women Won the Vote, Alice Paul, Lucy Burns, and Their Big Idea, by Susan Campbell Bartoletti, read by Sandy Rustin. A note before we begin. For a timeline of significant events, a list of further reading, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/How Women Won the Vote. Part 1. Under Arrest. Cannon Row Police Station, London, England, June 29th, 1909. Women milled about the London police station. It was a warm June night, but the women wore heavy coats, as if it were a blustery and cold winter day. Their coats were torn and tattered and covered with dirt, their buttons popped and hanging by a thread, their knees scraped and bloody, their throats were bruised. The women, 108 in all, were under arrest. We want to vote, too. The trouble started earlier that evening. 200 women had lined up at Caxton Hall to march in a protest parade. The women were suffragettes. They were protesting because women did not have suffrage, or the right to vote, in Great Britain, and that posed a big problem. They wanted a say in their government. The suffragettes were marching to Parliament. Once there, the women would demand to speak to the Prime Minister. The suffragettes would demand that members of Parliament, MPs, grant British women the right to vote. The marchers knew trouble was brewing. The women had warned one another. Wear your heaviest, thickest coat. Wear extra layers. Stuff your clothing with rags. Wrap yourself with fat spinner's yarn and cardboard to protect your body. Two American women stood with the marchers. Alice Paul and Lucy Burns did not know each other yet. Soon, Alice and Lucy would meet. Very soon. At the signal, the all-female band started up. Drummers rumbled the air. Fifers shrilled their fifes. A protest song called La Marseillaise floated over the marchers. The drums and the fifes quickened each marcher's heart and her feet. Line marshals shouted the orders, "Eyes forward, shoulders back, move forward." Standoff. Along Victoria Street, 50,000 spectators cheered, "Votes for women! Votes for women!" Other spectators jeered, "Shame, shame, go home where you belong." Hecklers pelted the suffragettes with stones and eggs and rotten fruit and vegetables. Hecklers didn't believe women should protest. They didn't think women needed the right to vote. Hecklers said voting should be left up to men. The suffragettes marched on, eyes forward, shoulders back. Soon, Big Ben and the spires of St. Stephen's rose in the distance. And then, a wall of blue. A 50-year-old British woman named Emmeline Pankhurst led the suffragettes. Mrs. Pankhurst had transformed suffragists, women who asked for the right to vote, into suffragettes who demanded the right to vote. Head high, chin up, Mrs. Pankhurst and seven suffragettes stepped up to the gate. "We have come here in the assertion of a right," said Mrs. Pankhurst to the chief inspector of the police.
"The Prime Minister regrets that he is unable to receive the proposed delegation," said the chief inspector.
Mrs. Pankhurst wouldn't budge. Prime Minister Herbert Henry Asquith often met with men. It was only fair that he meet with women. The chief inspector didn't budge either. It was a standoff. And then, a police officer shoved Mrs. Pankhurst away from the gate. Mrs. Pankhurst slapped the officer across the face, twice. Right away, the chief inspector arrested Mrs. Pankhurst and the seven women. Mrs. Pankhurst knew what would happen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.